going to continue our series about renal allograft rejection diagnosis and differential diagnosis, and I'm going to discuss today the third part of this series. This was the last slide of the second part of this series, that antibody mediated rejection is considered one of very important causes of graft failure, either due to the development of the process of antibody mediated rejection or to non-adherence with the patient, so should educate the patient to continue adherent to immunosuppressive medication. To continue, I finished in this first two parts, acute cellular rejection or T-cell mediated rejection, antibody mediated rejection acute, and today I'm going to give you some ideas about the diagnosis and the management of chronic antibody mediated rejection. To start with, as I mentioned in the acute rejection, we depend on interpretation of letters. So we should know the letters for chronic antibody mediated rejection. For acute rejection, as I mentioned before, we depend in diagnosis of cellular rejection on knowing the how to diagnose I, interstitial inflammation, T, tubulitis, V, vasculitis, and then I added for the acute antibody mediated rejection, microvascular inflammations, G glomerulitis, peritubular capillaritis, and C4D deposition. Today I'm going to show you the terminology for chronic antibody mediated rejection. As I mentioned before, when we add letter C before the letter I, this means chronic changes in the interstitium. That means interstitial fibrosis. Up to 5% is considered zero if it is between 6 to 25% of cortical area affected by interstitial fibrosis, it is CI1. Between 26 to 50% of the cortical area, it is CI2. And if fibrosis affects more than 50% of the cortical area, it is CI3. So for the pathologist to interpret, should look at the interstitium, and we should look at the description of the interstitium. If it's affected by fibrosis, I look at the scoring and the grading of fibrosis. If it is less than 25%, between 6 to 52, and above 50%, it is CI3. When letter C is added to T, it is not tubulitis, it is tubular atrophy. What's meant by tubular atrophy? Normally, each tubule lies beside each other, so back to back. If they lie far from each other, this is considered tubular atrophy. Zero, no tubular atrophy. Less than 25%, it is CT1. Between 26 to 52, and above 50% of the cortical tubules are atrophic, it is CT3. One of important parameters that we depend upon for diagnosis of chronic antibody mediated rejection is the presence of allograft glomerulopathy, CG. So G glomerulitis in acute, and here this is CG transplant glomerulopathy. If it is less than 10% of the capillary lobes affected with double contours, it is CG0. 25% 1, 26 to 50% is 2, and above 50% of the capillaries are affected by double contour appearance, it is CG3. So the presence of transplant glomerulopathy or allograft glomerulopathy, which is known as CG, is very important for diagnosis of chronic antibody mediated rejection. MM means mesangial matrix increase. No, zero. Moderate in up to 25%, one. And between 26 to 50% it is two, and above 50% is three. So again, we have here our terminology in chronic antibody mediated rejection, interstitial fibrosis, tubular atrophy, allograft glomerulopathy, mesangial matrix increase. If we look here carefully, we find the tubules are apart from each other, and there is wide areas of interstitial fibrosis. And here, the transplanted glomerulopathy thickening and double contouring appearance of the glomeruli CG. Regarding the vessels, here no vasculitis. It is not V vasculitis, it is CV, means intimal vascular fibrosis, CV. Zero, no chronic vascular changes. CV1, fibrointimal thickening with up to 25% luminal narrowing, breach of elastica or foam cells. CV2, between 26 to 50% narrowing of the lumen and most severely affected vessels. And CV3, more than 50% or equal 50% narrowing of the lumen. So it is chronic fibrosis. Arterial hyaline thickening, AH, zero, no past positive hyaline thickening of arterioles. One, mild to moderate, H2 moderate, and H3, severe hyaline thickening of the many arterioles. So again, for the chronic antibody-mediated rejection, we have CI, CT, and the as I mentioned before, this again and again, CI, interstitial fibrosis, CT, tubal atrophy, CG, allografted glomerulopathy, MM, mesangial matrix increase, and the CV, intimal vascular fibrosis, AH, arterial hyaline thickening. If we follow here, major thickening and narrowing, extensive chronic changes in the graft. So this is, these are the letters, how to interpret, how to put them together to diagnose chronic antibody-mediated rejection according to the revised BAMF 2013 classification. As I mentioned, in acute antibody-mediated rejection, three criteria should be fulfilled. Morphology, evidence of current or recent antibody interaction with vascular endothelium, and lastly, serological evidence of donor-specific antibodies. The morphology here, either the presence of transplant glomerulopathy, CG, more than zero, if no evidence of chronic thrombotic microangiopathy, or severe peritubal capillary basement membrane multi-layering, or arterial intimal fibrosis of new onset, excluding other causes. Evidence of current or recent antibody interaction with vascular endothelium, including at least one of the following: linear C4D staining in peritoneal capillaries, C4D2 or 3 by immune fluorescence, or above zero by immune histochemical on paraffin section. At least moderate microvascular inflammation, G and BTC exceeding 2, equal or exceeding 2. Increased exhibition of gene transcript in the biopsy tissue, indicative of endothelial injury. And lastly, serological evidence of donor-specific antibody. So, acute and chronic antibody-mediated rejection are characterized, both of them, with evidence of current or recent antibody interaction and the presence of donor-specific antibody. This is, these criteria are present in both forms of acute and chronic. How to differentiate acute and from chronic is by looking at the morphology. So here we look at transplant glomerulopathy, peritoneal capillary, not capillaritis, but multilayering of basement membrane, arterial intimal fibrosis. In the acute form, we depend on glomerulitis, peritoneal capillaritis. So this is our presence of severe vasculitis or ATN. So these are the morphology of acute and chronic. So for chronic antibody-mediated rejection, morphology of chronic tissue injury, plus the evidence of current or recent antibody interaction, plus the presence of donor-specific antibody in the serum. So this is the morphology. Here you can find double contour appearance of the capillary basement membrane, C4D staining, multilayering of peritoneal capillaries, thickening here. So this is the morphology. And by electron microscope, if you look at this sector, find a lot of multilayering. So multilayering of capillaries is indicative of the presence of chronic antibody-mediated rejection. If we continue and completing the all three criteria. What is the role of electron microscope in renal allograft biopsy evaluation in general? And because I mentioned the presence of peritoneal capillary multilayering is one of indicative of presence of chronic changes that may indicate chronic antibody mediated rejection. The indication in general for performing electron microscope in the renal allograft biopsies if glomerular disease was the cause of end-stage renal failure. So if we want to diagnose the recurrence of podocytopathy, like effacement of food process, we should have electron microscope. If there is clinical or pathological suspicion of glomerular disease, in particular in the case of membranoproliferative pattern glomerular changes on light microscopy, if the patient is at risk for or has histologic evidence of antibody mediated rejection, in order to establish a diagnosis of ultrastructure, only chronic active antibody mediated rejection in late indication biopsies if the biopsy is done beyond 1 year of after transplantation. Again, to summarize, according to Banff 2013, we have two types of antibody mediated rejection, C4D positive and C4D negative. C4D positive means that C4D is present either by immunohistochemical staining on paraffin tissue or immune fluorescent frozen section, and C4D negative. So to diagnose, donor-specific antibody should be present in the positive or negative. Immunopathological evidence diffuse C4D or focal or diffuse by immune histochemical C4D staining. Here, if it is negative, there is no C4D, but there is endothelial activation, evidence of microinflammation, etc. Histology evidence of acute ATN, peritoneal capillaritis, glomerulitis, arterial fibronecrosis, no evidence for coronary capillary injury. And here, histology, peritoneal capillaritis, glomerulitis, rheumatoid microangiopathy, as I mentioned before, arterial fibronecrosis, no evidence of coronary capillary. So if I stop here, this and the all three criteria are present, this means acute antibody mediated rejection, either positive or negative C4D. If there is no histological evidence of acute, but there is histological evidence of chronic in the form of transplant glomerulopathy, peritoneal capillary basement membrane multi-lamellations or multi-layering, in the presence of IFTA, intracerebral fibrosis atrophy, fibrous intimal thickening of arteries, may be accompanied by glomerulitis and capillaritis, as I mentioned, that it may denote the current vascular affection. Here, if the C4D negative, transverse glomerulopathy, peritoneal capillary basement membrane multilayering, fibrous intimal thickening of arteries, may be accompanied by glomerulitis or capillaritis. So the difference between acute and the chronic antibody mediated rejection in the form of the histopathological evidence of acute or chronic. The presence of antibodies in the donor, donor-specific antibody in the serum, is the, in the acute and the chronic, in the C4D positive and negative. This is one of the salient features for diagnosis. And then the immunopathological evidence, as I mentioned before. How to prevent chronic antibody mediated rejection? Through desensitization for prevention of chronic antibody mediated rejection, and prevention rather than treatment appears to be a more effective option for reducing the incidence of chronic antibody mediated rejection. Plasmapheresis, IVIG, and rituximab seem the most effective of the current desensitization protocols. And if we look here, these are three treatment protocols. One of them is rituximab and IVIG, which is one. Two, rituximab, IVIG, and bortezomib is two. And three, rituximab, IVIG, bortezomib, and plasmapheresis. The same management used in acute antibody can be used in for prevention and treatment of chronic antibody mediated rejection. And combination therapy for chronic antibody mediated rejection might be effective even in patients with relatively late stage chronic antibody mediated rejection. Although the number of patients in each study will find them a few patients, but give some clue here in this pediatric experience, the usage of IVIG, 1 gram per kg, 4 doses in this time frame, and with rituximab, 375 milligram per square meter, the decrease of GFR could be significantly reduced by this regimen over 2 years, the treatment may be of value. One of important question, can we diagnose rejection by using non-invasive methods, and for here I'm discussing the role of radiology. This is a Doppler examination. This is a gray scale. This is the graft in longitudinal axis, and this is the cross-sectional area, and measuring cross-sectional area and monitoring the serial changes in cross-sectional area may give clue for edema of the graft. This is a Doppler study of the graft. Here, the flow in the graft is intralinear, and this is showing that the flow is in the systole biphasic, in the systole and the diastole. So we measure the peak velocity in the systole, it is S, and the flow at the end of the diastole, it is D, and then we can measure all these indices. The resistive index, for example, is S minus D divided by S. So here it is 0.66, it's normal. The perfusion phase here, we can see that the perfusion reaches to the capsule, so it's perfect perfusion. This is our Doppler study of normal graft. How to apply in acute rejection? This is the correlation of cortical perfusion, resistive index, with biopsy showing different degrees of rejection. So this perfusion is preserved in the borderline, acute tubular injury, acute cyclosporine toxicity, and it is affected, and the affection is increased with the higher degrees of rejection. So it affects, the rejection affects graft perfusion, and this is the resistive index. Higher resistive index is not specific for anything, but when we combine affected perfusion plus higher resistive index, it may give a clue for the diagnosis of rejection. Perfusion is intact, so it's here you may deal with borderline. Moderate affected in acute rejection, here grade 2, case of grade 2. Here no perfusion in this area, in the cortical area. Severe acute graft rejection, impairment of perfusion, and absent diastolic flow. In acute tubular necrosis, high risk of index, but the perfusion is preserved. Again and again and again, the diagnosis of rejection depends upon histology. And the usage of non-invasive like Doppler may give a clue just to give piece of puzzle that may help in botting the professional diagnosis, but to be sure of diagnosis, the gold standard is still biopsy. This one of the MRI studies published from this is showing the frame, and this is the computerized aided diagnosis system to non-invasive evaluatory transplant, and this is the role of diffusion noted MRI in diagnosis of acute renal allograft dysfunction, a prospective study from Urology and Free Center. Again, even if the study shows some data, but it's still preliminary, and the diagnosis of rejection depend on the pathology. So do we have an accurate non-invasive method? The answer is not yet for diagnosis of rejection. What's new in this issue? I'm going to stress upon the importance of de novo donor-specific human leukocyte antigen antibody in non-cell kidney transplant recipient after TCL mediated rejection. I think if the idea is whenever we diagnose TCL mediated rejection, we should thoroughly treat the patient. And if the patient doesn't respond to TCL mediated rejection, we should be afraid of development of antibody or the presence of another component of antibody mediated rejection. So T-cell mediated rejection inside the immune cells for the antibody mediated rejection. And this is one of the, in the June issue of the current open of organ transplantation, T-cell mediated rejection of kidney in the era of non-specific antibody diagnosis challenge and clinical significance. And the key points of this review are T-cell mediated rejection remains a significant cause of graft dysfunction in the era of donor-specific antibody testing. There is a bidirectional relationship between T-cell mediated rejection and antibody mediated rejection. What does it mean? It means if you have T-cell mediated rejection, this may sensitize the patient for the antibody formation and antibody mediated rejection. And whenever you find antibody mediated rejection and find T-cell infiltration, T-cell mediated rejection may accompany the antibody mediated rejection. So both of them may lead to each other. The therapeutic armamentarium for rejection must contain both anti-B and anti-CL strategies. So we should put this in our mind And whenever the T-cell maturation is not completely reversed, we should think of the antibody components. Detection of, detecting the humoral allo-immune responses, we need more than serum antibody screening. This is a very nice study showing that the we can use tests to search for specific memory cells for T and B. This may add to the issue. So where as many techniques exist to detect HLA antibodies in the sera of immunized individuals, assays to detect and quantify HLA-specific B cells are only just emerging, and it may add a lot for in the absence of antibody by the methods present for detection of antibody. The need for such an assays is becoming clear, as in some patients, HLA-specific memory B cells have been shown to be present in the absence of accompanying serum HLA antibodies, because HLA-specific B cells in the peripheral blood of immunized individuals are present only a few, very low frequency, assaying with high sensitivity are required. In this review, the authors discussed the currently available methods to detect and quantify HLA-specific B cells, as well as their promises and limitations. They discuss also scenarios in which quantification of HLA-specific B cells may be of additional value besides classical serum HLA antibody detection. So when I ask my question as transplant physician, do we have an accurate immunometry? The answer, we don't have. We cannot predict accurately or diagnose accurately the level of immunity of the patients. So by this, I reach the end of diagnosis of acute and chronic rejection by different types and how to manage. As I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, the first part, not every case of graft function reflects the diagnosis of rejection. We may have all other etiology that I mentioned before. So whenever we have graft dysfunction, especially if it's early, we should put the causes of kidney, even in the general, renal failure or acute kidney injury, pre-renal, post-renal, and renal. So if you have patient with septic shock, you may predict ischemic insult or toxic insult for the kidney. If the patient's hypovolemic, you may have acute tubular injury. If the patient received drugs that may injure the kidney tubule, may have acute tubular injury. This is one of the forms. So here, this is one of the slides of Professor Helmut Rinke. I have the honor to work with him in 2009 to join him in his pathology lab. So this is at Brigham and Women's Hospital. This is tubule with thinning lining, and this is a debris inside the lumen. So this is well-established acute tubular necrosis. C4D here is negative, so it's not antibody maturation. Donor specific antibody is negative, so this isolates acute tubular injury. A lot of causes may lead to acute tubular injury, and whenever we diagnose, we observe the patient for recovery, and then this is the diagnosis. One of the important drugs that we use that may affect the kidney is calcium inhibitor nephrotoxicity. And when we review the literature, you will find some authors overestimate the calcium inhibitor-related nephrotoxicity, and some other underestimate. So, during calcium inhibitors, we have two drugs, cyclosporin and tacrolimus. If you look here to this United States Renal System, from the mid-90s, the use of cyclosporin is decreasing in the renal transplantation, and this is the current few patients are currently treated with cyclosporin. And here, tacrolimus increases up to the majority of immune suppressor protocol currently depend on tacrolimus, not cyclosporin. This is one of the slides of Professor Helmut Rinke showing the vacuolization of the tubule. So the acute calcium inhibitor nephrotoxicity may be presented by vacuolization of the tubule, some sort of tubular injury. And whenever we diagnose acute vacuolization, the classic is isometric vacuolization of the tubule, as you see from this spot slow vacuolization of the tubule. So just decreasing the drug may help a lot. But we should put in our mind other causes of vacuolization like electrolyte disturbance, especially hypokalemic nephropathy. It's one of our slides showing the thrombus inside the afferent arteriosus. So this is thrombotic microangiopathy due to cyclosporin. This is the case of cyclosporin. And whenever we diagnose cyclosporin-related thrombotic microangiopathy, we may change it to tacrolimus. And if it's tacrolimus-related, we can change it to cyclosporin. Also, everolimus may be associated with thrombotic microangiopathy. This is the chronic changes, ionization of the tubule of the vessels, and here the strep fibrosis. This the strep fibrosis by trichrome stain. So we have acute calcium inhibitor related nephrotoxicity and the chronic, the acute. The histology for acute is vascularization of the tubule, and the histology for chronic is vasculopathies and strep fibrosis. Regarding the calcium inhibitors, I'm stressing upon the best usage of these drugs. So tacrolimus trough level of the discharge to predict acute rejection, so should be keen in monitoring and successful in monitoring tacrolimus trough level. Trough level means level before the dose to be within the therapeutic arena. In the early period when we started the usage of tacrolimus in renal transplantation, we used high levels. So at that time, we experienced in our center, Mansoura, a lot of toxicity, tremors, and diabetes. But when we used the current recommendations, in the early weeks, we used the level between 8 to 10 nanogram per ml. And after that, 4 to 8, this is accepted, and we found the side effects decreased. But this is very important. The discharge level should be adequate. So here, if you look at the tacrolimus level at the time of discharge, you'll find a big variety among different patients. If the level is less than 8 nanogram per ml, the biopsy-proven acute rejection increases by 2-fold. So should monitor the level thoroughly and deal with. Why there is big variation in the drug levels, although we use the same dosage? The answer is a lot of causes may explain this variability. One of these is the ABCB genetic polymorphism. ABCB is the gene that codes for multi-drug resistance, is the multi-drug resistant gene that codes for transporter glycoproteins or drug efflux system. And this will be clear in this cartoon. Suppose that you are dealing with the patient with CC genotype. CC genotype has a pump system, active pump system. So this is the lumen of the intestine, and for tacrolimus to absorb it should go through this direction from the lumen to intestinal cells and then the blood. So if you have here in the apical membrane, the intestinal cells, an active the pump system, so the minority of the drug will be absorbed. So and this is if the genotype is CT, the pump is midway, so moderate amount of the drug are absorbed. And this is if the genotype is TT, the pump is very weak, so the majority of drug amounts are absorbed. So if we use fixed dosage formula, 0.1 milligram per kg per day, so for all these three genotypes, what is your expectation? Sure, we'll find a different level because the absorption capacity is different from CC, CT, and TT patients. One of interesting issue, the pump system, efflux system, is not only present in the intestinal cell, but may present at the site of action, so it may affect the pharmacodynamic and the sort of action of tacrolimus in the T-lymphocytes. So there is also genetic polymorphism that determine the pump system in lymphocytes. So by this way, you may have different effect on different patients. So this is different effect, and the previous one, different levels. Again and again, one of the reasons why persons are different in response to the dosage of tacrolimus, one of these is the different metabolism. This is the tacrolimus is metabolized through cytochrome B3A5 system, and this system has many genotype genetic polymorphism. So if you look at the African American, the black patients, this 1-1 or 1-3, all these are persons with expressing the enzyme. So these patients are metabolizing drugs, either homozygous or heterozygous. And the white part reflects, the white sector of this pain, it reflects patients who are non-expressors. So they are slowly metabolizing the drug. If you look here for the Caucasian, you find the reverse. 85% of the person, the Caucasians are slowly metabolizing the drugs. And if you look to South Asian, 50%. So if we use single dose formula for all these persons, you will expect that the level will be different because the metabolism is different. So again, why the persons have different levels? Because they may have different reabsorption capacity or different metabolizing capacity for tacrolimus. One of the application of the of this interaction and this understanding for tacrolimus is development of drugs that may even affect the pump on the pancreas and kidney, because the main thorn in the side of calcium inhibitors are nephrotoxicity and diabetogenic potentiality. So if we add to the tacrolimus a drug that enhance the pump at the kidney and the pump at the pancreas, we may lessen, may decrease the side effects, and I think this is under development. So if we know the genetic makeup of the patients, we may start for the patients who expressing cytochrome system, who are enzyme expressor, and the genotype for the ABCB multidrug resistance showing that the genotype is CC means that the bump, the genotype is TT means the bump is very low in activity. So if you have patients with low metabolism and low bump, you may use a small dose, and vice versa. If the metabolism is high and absorption is low, you need large doses. So according to the multidrug resistant genetic polymorphism and cytochrome B system genetic polymorphism, we may, before at the starting of this tacrolimus level, we may use different dosage regimen to cope, because we don't like to use high dosage of the drug leading to toxicity for patients who need lower drug dosages. And at the same time, we don't like to use lower dosage of the drugs for patients who need large doses to avoid rejection. I think we should stop now, and we'll continue in the fourth sector, the rest of the differential diagnosis of rejection. Thank you for attention, and I'll be happy if I receive your questions. Bye-bye.